Thanks so much for joining us at VIVE Church for our podcast. We're currently in an amazing series, As It Is in Heaven. If you have a story to share about what God is doing in your life or what God's done for you, we'd love to hear from you. Send us an email at mystory@vivechurch.org.
I want to welcome San Jose right now. Fine bunch of looking people. And San Francisco and Palo Alto. It's great to have everybody join together. I love being one church in many locations. That all over the Bay Area, Vive Church, you can find yourself in a place where God's heaven is open over people, speaking directly into your life. And I trust you're going to receive the word. I'm excited for the word today. And it is my privilege, our privilege, in fact, to have some of the best communicators on planet Earth that come through this church. And today is no different. We're privileged. I've invited my dear friend, Pastor Jake Sweetman from C3 Los Angeles. And him and his wife, Nicole, are building something unique and incredible in one of the most amazing cities in the world and having an incredible influence as they occupy neighborhoods in Los Angeles. And not only is he a dear friend, both of them, his wife and himself, but he is easily one of the best communicators of the gospel that you will come across. So you're in for a treat today. And I asked him to come and bless our church and to close out the series that we're currently in. And I believe he's got a word directly for you. But I want you to be on the edge of your seat. Palo Alto, San Jose. San Jose, I want you to be on the edge of your seat this morning and be drawing out the word of God because it transcends space. Amen. And so I believe it's going to be a word directly for you. But come on, why don't we give a big Vive Church welcome to Pastor Jake Sweetman as he comes to bring the word this morning. Amen.
Come on, if Jesus is your King, if He's your Lord, if He's your Savior, why don't you give Him a great praise right now in this place? Come on, the name of Jesus. Lord, we love you. Wow. Vive Church. Must mean there's revival happening here or something. For this many people to be at a 9:30 service, it must be revival. It's incredible. Our earliest service in LA is 11:30 because we don't get up before 11. So y'all are holy and righteous and all of that. So good to be here. Hey, touch your neighbor, say, I'm so glad I'm sitting next to you. Y'all may take your seats. It really is a privilege and a treat to be here with you all. I think it was just about a year and a half ago that I was here last. And it's just so good to see some familiar faces, but also some brand new faces as well. In fact, many brand new faces. And if you're new here, you should know that you're in a place that welcomes you and embraces you. And surrounded by people who are truly and genuinely glad that you're here. And are looking to invite you into this family and this community. And I promise you that if you hang around, if you stay, if you plant here, your life will be blessed because of it. No doubt in my mind. I just want to take a moment and really express just how much Pastors Adam and Kira mean to my wife, Nicole, and I. He said it, we really are dear friends, but just the way that they have journeyed with my wife and I over the last few years of our life has been such a gift. And the way that they've blessed us and downloaded so much wisdom into us, I don't know that we would be where we are without them. And I know that when you know you're around it all the time, it's easy to take it for granted that you guys are tremendously blessed to have this couple as your pastors and your leaders. And I think we should just let's praise God for the fact that He's blessed y'all and given you good shepherds to care for you. And we love you guys. Y'all are amazing. And thank you for having me. It's so good to be here. And I'm excited to talk about prayer. We did a series on prayer last year, and it was my favorite of the year. And so I'm excited to share around this subject. What I'm going to do, where's the clock? There's the clock right there. What I'm going to do is, just for the next few moments, I just want to talk about prayer, maybe from an angle that you haven't heard before. And I want to invite us as a people into a place of more intimacy with God in our prayer, and invite you to take maybe one or two more steps into the place of prayer that you hadn't considered going before. But I am going to speak about it from the perspective of somebody who has a relationship with God already. And so if you're here today, and I'm completely aware that we're all brought up with different backgrounds and we're raised with you know, different beliefs that surround us, if you're here today and you're not yet somebody who feels like you know God, like you have a relationship with God, then at the end of this message, just as I always do and every time that I preach, I'm going to give you an opportunity to take a step into that relationship with God. Because what I'm going to speak about for the next 30 minutes or so will be immediately available to you as soon as you put your faith into practice and choose to begin that relationship with God. So I hope to inspire us in that, and I'll give you an opportunity at the end of the service to make that decision to put your trust in the Lord, put your trust in Jesus, and begin that relationship today. Come with me to the book of Matthew chapter 6 and verse 5. I feel like y'all already know me somewhat, so I'm going to skip all the personal stuff because we got limited time together. We're family here. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 5. Jesus speaking here says, "And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites." Everyone say, he's going for the jugular. "For they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, don't heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Don't be like them." Touch your neighbor and say, "Don't be like them." "For your Father knows what you need before you ask him." If you're taking notes this morning, and I highly encourage you to do so, you can write down the title of the message. It's called Teach Us to Pray. Teach us to pray. And just to make sure that at the 9:30 service we are feeling verbally engaged, I need you to find three people and just let them know, hey, he's going to teach us to pray today. He's going to teach us to pray today. Come on, say it with some excitement, with some enthusiasm. He's going to teach us to pray today. And with that, let's pray one more time and ask God to bless this time together. Father, we thank you for your word. It's living, it's active, it's true, sharper than any two-edged sword. I pray that as it goes forth this morning, that people would be blessed by it and that we would be drawn near to you, that we would have an experience with you, God, that we wouldn't just learn about you and wouldn't just gain knowledge or information, but God, we would experience you in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. Amazing. Thank you so much. You are a blessing. Come on, let's give her a hand. You're incredible. What great worship. My goodness. Incredible. Hey, I am here with a friend of mine, Rob Elmore from C3 LA, who produced that first song that you guys were singing, yours. So it's good to have him here. Teach us to pray. Do you remember the last time that you were like really impressed with something? Maybe it was the way somebody performed in their particular craft. Perhaps it was some incredible statistic or some architectural phenomenon. Maybe you've been recently impressed with the way a friend of yours has journeyed through a really difficult season in life. Maybe you found yourself impressed with somebody's memory or somebody's positive attitude or somebody's creativity or strength. There are, without a doubt, many things in this life with which we can be impressed as people. And I can't necessarily speak for everybody here today, but I think that we would all agree that when we encounter somebody who does something which really impresses us, the thing that we ask is, how do they do that? How do they sing so well? Or how did they get to be so creative? Or how do they know so much about that subject? And maybe for you, you've got a particular area of interest that when you see it done in an impressive manner, it draws you in to want to understand how it is the way that it is. For me, that thing is communication. I'm obsessed with communication done well, and more specifically, great communicators, because I understand that when communication is done well, it has the power to move people. And so when I see somebody who communicates at a level that impresses me, I don't just sit back and say, wow, that's impressive. I want to understand how they do what they
do. I want to know how they structure and put together a message. I want to understand why they chose to say that but not that. I want to know how it is they take somebody on a journey from A to B and create an experience for the listener. I don't just want to lean back and be impressed by it. I want to lean in and understand why it is the way that it is, so that I can apply it to myself and internalize it and get to the point where what they do can be applied to what it is that I do. This is actually one of the most common ways that you and I learn, by studying and analyzing and applying to ourselves. That's why we have the phrase watch and learn. I can see this natural curiosity even in my son. Winston is nearly 3 years old, and he's an absolute delight, as all three-year-old little boys are. And Winston is absolutely impressed by everything. Like, everything that my wife, Nicole, and I do impresses him to the nth degree. But he's not just impressed by it, he also wants to emulate everything that we do. And so Winston wants to get his own food from the refrigerator, and he wants to get himself dressed, and he wants to buckle his own seatbelt, and he wants to put his own toothpaste on the toothbrush. And never mind the fact that I'm losing half the tube of toothpaste in the process of trying to get it on the toothbrush, Dad. You're just gonna have to deal with this while I figure it out. I began to think about this idea of impressiveness and our desire for emulation because of one very simple request that we read in Luke's gospel in chapter 11. One day the disciples, they come to Jesus and they approach him and they say, "Lord, teach us to pray." And I guess upon initial study of that request that they make of Jesus, it might seem very simple. It might even seem like a request that we would expect the disciples to make of Jesus. After all, they are his students and he is their spiritual teacher. And so, of course, they would ask him about the subject of prayer, right? Why would you not ask Jesus about prayer? But when you begin to dive beneath the surface a little bit and you consider the fact that the people who are making this request are grown Jewish men who have been raised in a very religious society where prayer is mandated multiple times a day, you realize that they're not asking what you think they are asking on the surface. You see, it cannot be that they are seeking to understand the ritual of prayer. It cannot be that they are seeking to understand the practice of prayer. We need to understand that Peter is not asking Jesus, "What should we call God when we pray?" And John is not coming to Jesus and asking him, "What kind of words should we use as we pray?" For they have been brought up with religion and they've been brought up with the practice of prayer. And so those things they already know, and those things they've witnessed and practiced for as long as they can remember. And so there must be a question beneath the question. There must be a request beneath the request. And what dawned on me is that these men had never come across somebody as impressive as Jesus. You see, to follow Jesus would be to go to sleep every single night thinking to yourself, "What exactly did I experience today? Like, what was that?" Understand that Jesus did not occasionally do impressive things. He was always doing things that were impressive. In fact, the Gospel of John tells us that there are not enough books in the world to contain all of the great things that Jesus said and did. And so Jesus was in the habit of blowing your mind all the time. And by the time you put it back together, he blew it again. So this is just what it is to live with Jesus. This is how it is to follow him. He's a supernatural guy. Like, it's not a normal experience. And I guess what hit me is the fact that much of what Jesus did, which was impressive, he did by praying. And so when Jesus healed the sick, he prayed. And when Jesus opened blind eyes, he prayed. And when Jesus fed thousands of people with a few pieces of bread and fish, he prayed. And when Jesus felt intense pressure, he prayed. And when Jesus faced persecution, he went off and he prayed. And when Jesus was in the garden getting ready to lay his life down for you and I, he prayed. And when Jesus was hung on the cross, he prayed for the people who put him up there. And with Jesus' last final dying breath, he prayed. And so it has become super abundantly clear to the disciples that when this guy prays, incredible things happen. So it's not that they want to know about the ritual of prayer. It's not that they want to know about the practice of prayer. It's that in this guy, they've encountered something called the power of prayer. And they are seeking to understand that. Because when this guy prays, sickness vanishes. Limbs grow back. Blind eyes open. Food defies the natural order of things. Wind and waves bow down. Peace shows up in a way that they've never experienced before. And so they want to know not just how to pray, but how do I pray the way you pray? Anybody here want to know how to pray the way that Jesus prayed? It's an interesting idea, you see, because we understand that prayer is the power by which we move a mountain. But have we considered becoming students of prayer? And we understand that prayer is the power by which we slay a giant, but have we considered becoming students of prayer? And we know that prayer is the place that we can go to receive what we need in our time of need, but have we considered becoming students of prayer? And we know that the Bible says that the prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working, but have we considered becoming students of prayer? And so that makes the words that Jesus gives to us in Matthew chapter 6 so valuable, you see. Because although the Bible has a lot to say about the subject of prayer, Matthew 6 is one of the few places that the scriptures actually tell us how to pray. All throughout the scriptures, you'll find a lot of mention of prayer, but most of it will be around the idea of, hey, keep praying. Persist in prayer. Be continuous in your prayer. But in Matthew 6, we have the words of our Lord Jesus, who actually takes a moment to help us understand how is it that we pray. Should we take a moment to understand what Jesus is telling us? Come on, in SF, do you want to understand what Jesus is saying about prayer? So Jesus says, okay, you want to know how to pray? Well, for starters, definitely don't be like the hypocrites. They love to stand in the synagogues and at the street corners that they may be seen by others. And we might hear that and think, okay, that's an interesting direction to take this lesson plan, Jesus. Like, I was just wondering how to pray. I didn't need you to attack other people in the process of explaining to me, like, where are we going with this? But what we'll find out is that Jesus is actually about to teach us one of the most foundational truths about prayer. And it is that prayer is not so much a thing we do. Prayer is a place that we go. And you can write that down if you're taking notes. Prayer is not a thing. Prayer is, it's a place. It's a place that you enter into so that you can commune with and connect with and fellowship with God. Prayer is a place where you go so that what's going on in your world becomes infinitely less than it seems like it should be at the moment. And God's glory becomes infinitely more of what it should be in your life all the time. That's why Hebrews 4 and 16 says, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, because prayer is not a thing that we do, it's a place that we go. And notice that it says we're drawing near to the throne of grace. It doesn't say that we wait outside the door to be summoned. It doesn't say that we walk in and just wait at the doorway. It says, no, we come near to the throne of grace, because when you have been made righteous by the blood of Jesus, near to the throne is where you belong. That's the position that you have been afforded by the sacrifice of Christ when he laid down his life for you and I. And so prayer is a place that we go. And the reason Jesus says don't be like the hypocrites is because it's only when you don't care about the glory that you may get from praying in a public place that you can then enter into God's glory, which is found in the private place. It's only when you're willing to forego what might be shown on you when you stand up in front of people that you can then enter into God's glory, which is found in your private place of prayer. Now understand that Jesus is not condemning public prayer. Okay, obviously we stand up here and pray and you are the public. And so we are not against public prayer. And I guess what we need to understand is that a hypocrite is not somebody who does something publicly. A hypocrite is somebody who does something publicly, but something different privately. And so it is only when we are willing to forego whatever is put on us in a public place that we can enter into the glory that is found in the private place. And what Jesus is teaching us is that when you only care about the attention that you get, about the glory that you get from praying in a public place, your prayer lacks any power and it won't have any fruit and there won't be any harvest, because you'll only ever be praying for the attention of many as opposed to the audience of one. And the thing about it was, is these religious people that Jesus is referring to as hypocrites actually had to go to quite a bit of trouble to make sure that they were always in a public setting whenever the times of prayer rolled around. Like, they had to schedule their day around it. Like, when the time of prayer hits, I gotta make sure I'm on the busiest street corner there is so that people can see me be righteous and holy as I pray. And I know that you guys are, well, you're real Christians, so you've never done anything remotely close to that, but I'm still a work in progress, so I have. Many years ago, before my wife and I were even dating and I was in the stage of trying to win her affections, I would go to great lengths to try and impress my wife. And so at the time, she was working for my parents as their assistant. Yes, I married my dad's assistant. It's a thing, okay? So it is what it is. Like, to God be the glory. So she would come around to the house and make sure that it was clean for when my parents were coming into town and make sure the refrigerator was stocked, you know, like basic things that I'm not capable of doing. And so when she would knock on the door, this is like my opportunity. I can't let this pass by without taking advantage of this. So I thought, well, let's not just answer the door regularly. Let's answer the door without a shirt on. Right? That's not too forward at all. Like, that's what it, please. You guys should try that. So maybe don't try that, actually, on second thought. And so I would answer the door without a shirt on, and she like, oh, okay, what's going on here? And I would literally say something to the effect of like, I'm sorry, I was just in the middle of working out and I didn't have time to put a shirt back on. I didn't want to keep you waiting. But I wouldn't stop there. I would also make sure to put my Bible open on the kitchen table, because I didn't want her to just think I was physically strong, like I'm spiritually strong as well, okay? And it'd be turned to like one of the more impressive books, like Leviticus or something like that. And I'm sure she didn't believe any of it, because like, what were you doing? Were you working out or were you reading your Bible? Like, what is this? Well, obviously both. Like, I do push-ups and read Leviticus at the same time. It's really not a big deal. Like, and I'm sure she didn't buy any of it. Even though I went to a whole lot of effort and trouble to make sure that she believed I was doing both, I was really doing neither. And that was the thing about these hypocritical people, is they went to a whole lot of effort to make sure that people knew they were praying when they weren't really praying at all. In fact, Jesus goes so far as to say that even when they pray, they're not really praying. And the attention they get for praying the way that they do, well, that's the end of their reward right there. You want to know how to pray? Go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret. Now, how about that for a phrase? You have a Father who is in secret. So that when all other eyes are off you, the eyes that matter the most are still on you. And when nobody else's ears can hear you, the ears that matter the most are listening intently to every word that you have to say, wanting to respond to what it is that you are bringing to Him in your time of prayer. You see, prayer, I believe, might possibly be the greatest gift that is given to us by God next to our salvation. It is like God has told you about the coolest, most amazing secret hideout in all the world and given you a key so that you can go whenever you want. And no matter where you are, the journey is never far to get there. That word that Jesus uses, room, infers to a storehouse in their culture. It was the place where the people would keep all of their extra grain and wine, hello somebody, and oil and flour. It's where they would keep all of their extra provision. In other words, it's where they would keep what sustained them. And that is the picture that Jesus is giving us here, is that when you are willing to forego the glory that you get and are interested in the glory of your Father, you can go into a place where what you need is found, where all the provision you are looking for is found, where the sustenance you need is found. You just got to be willing to shut the door and go into that place where your Father is in secret. And then Jesus goes on to say, and when you do that, your Father will reward you. And the inference there, and maybe your translation even says this, is that He will reward you publicly. Now, what does that mean? Well, that means that for any person you see being promoted by God, you can be absolutely sure that they have paid an intense price in private. If you ever truly want to be able to stand before people, and I'm not talking about fame, I'm not talking about popularity. I really got to make that clear for my people in Los Angeles, because that's where their mind goes, right? But we're a different people here in the Bay Area. That's not what we're thinking, right? And so if you ever really want to truly be able to stand before people, I mean wield real authority and real influence and real power, that's what the gospel so frequently said about Jesus, is that this guy has an authority that we have not encountered before. And so if you ever want to be able to walk in that kind of spiritual power and influence and authority, you got to be somebody who is regularly on your knees before the Father. You cannot forego this and expect to have that, for this is simply a byproduct of this. And if you decide that you're going to spend all your Christian days never sacrificing your time, never putting off things that you'd rather do, so that you can go into your secret place and shut the door and spend time with your Father, the best you will ever receive is a mirage of what you're after, because it won't be the real thing. The real thing only comes from the sacrifice that they're willing to make. You see, it's got to be born out of a relationship. Prayer is what makes the person. Prayer is what makes the preacher. All preaching lacks any power if they have not spent any time in prayer with the Father. And so we got to understand that if we want to grow in the things of the Spirit, we got to go and make that time and set it aside so that we can spend time with Him. Because that is where the power is born out of. There's an account in the Gospels where Jesus walks up on his disciples. He's coming down from a moment of prayer with James and John on the mountain. They're coming down the mountain, and Jesus encounters the rest of his disciples, and they had been trying to cast a demon out of a boy. And they were not able to do so successfully. And so when Jesus arrives, the father of the boy is asking for help. Your disciples couldn't do it. Well, Jesus does it. Boom, it's done. As they are walking away, the disciples ask Jesus, how come we couldn't do it? Come on. And Jesus' response to that question always kind of puzzled me. Because what he says is, well, this kind can only be done through prayer and fasting, right? And so I'm reading that and I'm thinking, well, weren't they praying? Like, what else would they have been doing in trying to cast out the demon? So, like, they're praying, like, they're doing the best job that they can, yet they were not successful, so what's the deal? Like, is there some special demonic prayer code language that we need to know? Like, do they need to pray more intensely? Do they need to pray more loudly? Like what is it? What? Just tell me what I need to know, and I'll pray that way so that I can be successful the next time. And then what hit me is that it's not what they... Well, it wasn't the prayer in the moment that lacked power. It's the fact that they had waited for the moment to arrive to begin praying. You see, you and I would be able to overcome the obstacles that come at us so much more quickly and effectively if we didn't wait to start praying when the obstacle arose. But if we prayed in the days and the weeks and the months and the years that led up to the giant that tried to stand you down, you wouldn't be so intimidated by it in the first place, because you were getting strong back there. You wouldn't be so afraid of what's now staring you in the face. You see, you gotta be a person who's willing to have a life of sacrifice where it's not about everybody else looking at you. It's got to be about the eyes of your Father on you, who sees in secret, so that when you come against something that threatens you, you'll be able to overcome it with ease. It's prayer that leads up. You see, what we need to know is that the reason Jesus walked in the public power that he did is because he also walked in the private devotion that he had. You see, we often think that Jesus did the things that he did because he was God. Okay, so that's what we think. Like, okay, he healed because he was God. Right. And he did the miracles that he did because he was God. And he taught with such authority because he was God. And yes, Jesus is God. But what we have to understand is that Jesus did not just come to do what he did to prove that he was God. He came to do what he did to prove through what could be done through you when God is in you. And so Jesus didn't just come to die for your sins. He also came to show you how to live. Okay, so it's not just the fact that he's God that he's doing what he's doing. It's the fact that he is so dedicated to a private life of prayer that he was able to work with such public power. And if you and I would spend as much time in prayer as the Son did, I can guarantee you, you'd probably see a little more of the miraculous happening around your life when you're in a public setting. And you could pray and preach with authority and move with power, because you wouldn't be trying to muster up anything in the moment, because you had everything built into you back there. You see, there's a reason you can read your Bible and never come across anything that says, and Jesus had to get ready to do a miracle.
You won't ever find a scripture that says, and Jesus had to get ready to heal somebody, because he was always ready. You gotta stay ready. And the only way to be ready and to keep ready is to spend time in prayer. You see, this is the invitation that has been given to us. That we would go into that secret place and experience the Father in his presence. Jesus came to show us what is available. He came to show us what we are able to walk in when we carry his Spirit. And that's what happened when the church began. The very Spirit of God came to us. And we now carry that same Spirit. The Spirit that Peter carried 2,000 years ago is in every believer. It is in you. And you can walk in that. But you got to be willing to get alone with God and allow him to download into you and deposit into you and to build your faith in that moment so that you can walk in that in your life. And so I think that brings us to maybe one of the more predominant issues. When we pray, what do we say? Because, like, let's just state the obvious, like, God is invisible. So, like, when you're in your room with the door shut praying, like, like, there's nobody, like, you can't see anybody. At least I can't, anyway. Maybe, maybe up here in the Bay Area, we're a little more spiritual. They're all the wrong kinds of spiritual in LA, my man. And so, like, you're in there and you're in that place and, like, okay, where do I begin? What do I say? And I guess Jesus helps us with that. And the next thing that he says, the instruction that he gives, he moves on from the religious leaders of the day, and now he goes to the non-believers, the pagans, the Gentiles, the people who practiced idol worship. He says, well, don't be like them either. Because what they like to do is just drone on and on, praying mindlessly to their idol, thinking that they will be heard for their many words. Don't do that either. In other words, he's talking about a people who prayed mindlessly because they prayed to a mindless thing. You see, the way that you pray will always reflect who it is that you think you're praying to. And if you confuse yourself and think that you're praying to a mindless God, then you'll pray in a mindless manner. But if you can get a revelation that you are communicating to the greatest mind in existence, then all of a sudden you will start to engage your mind in ways that you never thought was possible. So don't pray mindlessly, because you're not praying to a statue without a brain. You're praying to the greatest mind that created everything that you can see. So engage that. Don't pray in a way that it depends upon the eloquence that you can string together. And don't pray in a way that you think it depends on the formula that you're using. And don't pray in a way where you think it's about the length of your prayer, because it's not necessarily about length as much as it is about weight. And so go into that place and pray with faith, because faith is weight in your words. And so understand that your words carry weight in that secret place of prayer. You got to pray with purpose. That's the second thing that you can write down. Pray on purpose. Don't pray mindlessly. Don't pray as if God isn't listening. Pray on purpose. God is listening. Pray as if your prayers actually make a difference, because guess what? They do. Pray as if what you're saying actually has an impact and an influence on your life and the lives of the people around you, because guess what? It does. You see, so often we go into that place of prayer, and what does it sound like? We say for 15, 20, 30 minutes, God, you're just awesome. God, I just love you. God, you're just incredible. I just bless your holy name. Like, can I just tell you, God is not insecure? And so go into that place of prayer and, yes, spend time worshiping and glorifying and adoring the Father. But God is not so insecure that he needs you to camp out there for 30 minutes. Like, you can go in with praise, go in with thanksgiving on your tongue. But when you have praised and when you have worshiped, God is waiting for you. He is asking you. He says, go on and make a request. Go on and pray with purpose. Go on and pray with weight. Go on and pray like it makes a difference in your life, because it does. And God is waiting to do things through you, but he won't be able to do them if you don't actually open up an opportunity for him to be able to walk through and do a miracle in your life. So pray like it matters. Every single one of us has the same authority, the same weight when we go into that place, that secret place. Maybe you're thinking, you know, I don't belong there. I can't go into that place. Friend, let me just tell you, you absolutely can. None of us are righteous. None of us are holy. All of us has fallen way short of the glory of God. Because of Jesus, because of what he has done, we have been made righteous. Like we can stand before the Father without spot or blemish. Like we stand in perfection because the perfection of Jesus has been imputed onto us. So you can come. It just begins with a relationship.
We hope you are blessed by this podcast. For more information for service times or for location, or to partner with us financially, visit us online at vivechurch.org.